So today I want us to talk a little bit about leadership. And over the recent weeks, one of the things that's been really encouraging to me is that I've seen a willingness and an ability of younger people to step up and lead about issues that they're passionate about. It seems that both locally and nationally, it's been young people have been initiating causes, who have been initiating these movements. And then it's the older people, the people in authority, who are having to kind of catch up and follow in their wake and get on board with the ways that younger people are leading. A local way that we've seen that happen is at Johnson Ferry and Roswell Road. If you've driven past there at all in the past week or so, especially last week, it just seemed like every single night there were people out there with signs, so excited, so passionate about racial equality and working towards that. And there was, it was a very diverse crowd as far as age and different ethnicities and everything, but it really was dominated by young people. And what's cool about that is I don't think that the teenagers and the early 20s type people who were out there sat around and waited for someone in authority to tell them and instruct them on how to do and how to lead in that area. They were just passionate, and they took the gifts and the things that they knew how to do, and they acted, and they got other people involved. Y'all, that's leadership. That's it. And what that shows me, plus a lot of other experiences I've had in student ministry, something that I've known maybe other people are kind of slow to get on board with, is that when you're passionate about something, you are able to be leaders. You have that ability, you have that willingness if it's something that you're passionate about. So before we get into talking too much about this idea of leadership, I want you in your life groups, together with your leader, hopefully you guys are doing this either in person or over a Zoom call. What are some times in your life that you personally have had an opportunity to lead? Doesn't necessarily have to mean that you had some sort of title or something, but it's just a time in your life when in some way, big or small, you got to be a leader. Talk about that in your groups. All right, so leadership is really important. And like I said, I think that you can be willing and I think that you're certainly able to be leaders. Here's the problem. A lot of the environments that you guys find yourselves in are content to just put you in the place of the attender while some person who is older and qualified and in authority over you does all the leading for you. And why? Because adulting is hard, right? And that's this false narrative, this belief, this stereotype that you're just a teenager. And that means you're immature, you're irresponsible, that you can't be trusted with things, or that you just simply don't care. And that's a real bummer. Because if you hear that message in your mind over and over and over again, you may be tempted to just go along with it and to just play into the stereotype. And if you do that, you'll find yourself just doing the bare minimum in any situation that you're in just to get through it until that magical day when you become an adult yourself. I guess it's the day that you finally iron the crease in your pleated khaki pants, or girls, you go for that matching color pantsuit and grab your briefcase and you're ready to be an adult. Well, I hope better for you guys. And I think that understanding that narrative is a key part of that. So take some time in your groups. Talk about this. What are some of the teenage stereotypes that you guys are aware of? Maybe you hear it from movies or from people in your life, but just list them all out. And then just ask yourself this question. Do you personally feel the temptation to play into those stereotypes? How do those stereotypes affect your life? So the sad part about everything we're just talking about is this. It happens in the church all the time. And not just for students, but this is for people of all ages who have bought into this false narrative that church is just something that you attend. That there are the paid professionals who are in charge of leading the church, and your job is to show up once a week and sit in a chair as you attend service, right? Isn't that the phrase we've all heard so much? But it's the pastors who are paid to lead everything. So they make the events, they lead the Bible studies, they teach the Bible, and you Just show up and you will become mature in Christ if you do that. But do you think that's the case? Have you felt that experience that just showing up and sitting is what is leading you into maturity, to becoming more like Christ? So students, the question is church a place for you to show up and just do the bare minimum, to attend 75% of the weeks and to be there for an hour, and then now you are mature in Christ? Or catch this vision. Could the church be a place where you go to be a part of something, where you go to put your gifts to work, where you become passionate about using who God has made you to be in order to become a leader? The truth that God wants us to know from His Word is that you don't go to church. You are the church. I want to stress that because it's so important. Church is not something that you go to. You are the church. And so in the new normal, we need to take a good look at what it means to be leaders and not attenders. So in Paul's letter to the Ephesians, he focuses on a lot of things about God's design for the church. He talks about how it's shaped by the gospel. He talks about how we need to be unified together as a church and some of the things that we do. But one of the things that he really focuses on is the ways that people can be a part of and lead in the church. So I want you guys to look in Ephesians chapter 4, because he says something really interesting here, and I want to give you some time to talk about it as a group before I dive into it too much. So you're going to look at Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16, and I'd like for you just to read through that and just kind of, what are some observations that you see? What are some of the things that are standing out to you? Truths about the church that Paul is trying to say in those verses. Take some time in your groups and talk about those things. All right, guys, let's take a look at this together. I think there's really three important things that we need to take away from this passage. They're going to help us to realize that we don't go to church, but we are the church, and that in the new normal, we need to be leaders and not just attenders. So the first one is this. Through Christ, God has given each of us, that is every single one of you watching this video, not just your leaders, not just me, each of us, gifts that are designed to be used in a unique way to lead the church. Look what it says right at the beginning, verse 11. So Christ himself gave, and he lists off several different things. Paul stresses that these gifts that are meant to serve the church body come from God, that they are designed uniquely for specific people. There's going to be some verses below the screen that that also speak to that. Maybe take a picture of that or write those down and look those up in your own time. They further support that. But the main point here that we need to know is that God designed each of you with unique gifts for the specific purpose of serving the church. And he lists a few of those gifts here, like being teachers and prophets and evangelists, and we're not going to get into the nitty-gritty of what each of those are, but they're not all the gifts. There's many more. The point that you need to know is you have a question to ask yourself. What gifts has God given me to use for the church? And the fact that they come from God should do a couple things. It should make us humble, for one thing. It's not just because you're somehow talented or you're some kind of all-star. Like, you have gifts that come from God. They are a gift. And it should also hopefully motivate you to want to use those gifts to serve the church, right? So we each have unique gifts that come from God. The second thing is this, that the work of the ministry is not my job. It is not Brian Weatherholt's job. It's your job. And that's a real twist for some people. But we need to look at this. The church, obviously, Johnson Ferry pays people to work for it, right? It employs people. I do have a job with the church. And typically people who are hired to work full-time in a church have these types of gifts, like teachers and evangelists and pastors. But when we're doing our job the best, we're not trying to do all the work of the ministry, but we're investing in and equipping people to do the work of the ministry. Look at verse 12. Paul says, Christ gave these apostles and prophets and teachers, verse 12, to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in faith and knowledge of the Son of God. But Paul is saying is like, yes, some people are gifted in certain ways. Some people are further along in their journey and they're going to have certain leadership roles. But our job portion of the ministry that Christ has given to us, to me, as one of those people who are employed, is to help invest in and to pour my life out into other people so that they can do the work of the ministry, so that they can be passionate about the gospel, so they can find people to share the gospel with and bring along in their faith journey. So it's important that you never get this idea that they do it, that they lead it. You are the church, students. You are the ones who need to do the ministry of the church, these works of service, these leadership opportunities. So ministry, it's not my job. It's your job. And I, of course, want to do ministry too, but not as a part of my job, as a part of my calling to Christ. So that's the second thing. Third thing is this. Leading, being active, like stopping this whole idea of sitting in chairs and attending, but leading, that is the only way that you're ever going to become mature in Christ. Things like Bible study, scripture memory, discussion groups, those are all great things, but they're tools. They're tools that are used to help craft you, to form you into the image of Jesus. They're not the end goal. Look at verse 13. Until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. So let me ask you, do you think you'll ever attain the full measure of what it means to be made in the image of Jesus Christ by showing up once a week and sitting in a chair? Do you think that's how Jesus approached his faith? How can you become like Jesus, who went out to people, who poured his life out to people, who served others, who ministered to the sick and to widows and to orphans, who recruited disciples, who trained them, who developed them, and then sent them out on mission? How can you ever become like that if all of our faith is passive? If we're just receive instruction and grow in knowledge as we sit with our butts firmly planted in plastic seats? You can't do it. The only way to attain to the full measure of maturity in Christ, the way that you were designed to be, is to start leading, to start being an active part of the church. All that is to say this. Biblically speaking, in this book, there's nothing that would lead us to believe that this model of showing up and attending service is at all what God designed the church to be like. In the new normal, we need to see ourselves as leaders in the church and not just attenders. So very quickly, I want to talk about how do we do that. In the time we have in this format, we're not going to get into a lot of things. So this isn't everything. It's just one thing, right? Because, of course, becoming more passionate about the gospel is huge. Sharing your faith in the way that we do that is huge. Volunteering and serving in different roles is huge. But here's one thing that I want you to focus on and latch on to as a way that you can start to become a leader and not just an attender. It's this idea, maybe you've heard this before, about having a Paul, having a Barnabas, and having a Timothy. And I don't know of a better way to say it, but those are three people who their lives are talked about in the Bible. And here's what we mean by that. Who is Paul? Who is our Paul? Paul is someone who is very far along in his faith. He was definitely a leader. He was wise. He was someone further down the road. So a Paul is someone in your life who's investing in you. Someone further down the road who's pouring into your life so that you have something to attain to, right? So you need to have a Paul in your life. but you also need to have a Barnabas in your life. Now, in the Bible, if you read in Acts, Paul and Barnabas are buddies. They are kind of co-equals in their faith in that they're about the same place in their journey, and they're doing ministry together. They're going out on mission trips together. They're establishing churches together. So your Barnabas is a peer, someone that you're leading along with, right? And then we all need to have a Timothy in our life. Timothy was a believer in Christ that Paul, he was younger, he was not as far along in his faith, and Paul sort of took him under his wing and helped to disciple him, helped to lead him, help him to develop and mature into the person that Jesus had designed him to be. So our Timothy is someone that you invest in. So we need the Paul, the Barnabas, and the Timothy. Someone that's investing in us. Someone that we're doing ministry with, and that's someone that we're ministering to, that we're investing in. So each of us should have one of those people in our lives, because we need to know that leading is not just about having titles. Leading is not just about having authorities. Oftentimes, leading is just the relationships that we have, the people that we're learning from, doing ministry with, and the people that we're investing in. And through that process, God can start to take the gifts that He's designed for you in your life to put them to work towards an incredible purpose, a purpose that we all should be passionate about. I'm going to pray for you guys, and I want you to discuss the things that'll be on the screen. And thank you so much for joining again as we get into the Word together. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this time. Thank you for your Word. Thank you for your church. Thank you for the example that we see in Jesus and Paul and Barnabas and Timothy. God, would you give us not less passion for other things, God, but God, even more passion for the gospel, more passion for the kingdom, so that way we would not be content to just sit in plastic chairs and watch other people lead the faith, but God, that we would become the leaders of the church, that these students would see themselves as the church, as leaders, not just attenders. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys.